Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the latest in our Workplace Spotlight series, Coloring Outside the Lines, Deconstructing Talent Best Practices to Find What Really Works. We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our panel. We'll begin with a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. And questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast. In fact, we definitely encourage you to do so by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. And I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. Today's webcast is certified for SHRM, HRCI, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Wolters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. And as a reminder, for those that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to at least 4 of the 6 polling questions that we will have throughout the session to qualify. And going to the link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. I would encourage you to download the CPE certification information PDF in the resource list area as well to serve as instructions on how to access your certification. Lastly, before I introduce today's panel, I just want to review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice, and before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we are discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics, and nothing here is intended to be a political opinion. And with that, I'm very excited to introduce today's panel, Trish McFarland, Dr. Susan Handels, and Jen Phillips Kirkwood. Trish is the CEO of H3 HR Advisors and CEO co-founder of the HR Federation. She is a former HR executive, HCM product leader, and analyst with over 20 years of experience in Big Four public accounting, PR, healthcare, manufacturing, and IT. She is the author of the popular HR Ringleader blog and co-host of the most listened to HR industry podcast, the HR Happy Hour. Trish recently released her 2019 HCM Trends Report, where she and colleagues with the HR Federation identified where the industry is headed. Dr. Susan Handels is a talent strategy expert and key thought leader with more than 20 years of results-based leadership experience as an executive coach and organization development expert. As a VP in ADP's Strategic Advisory Services Group, Susan collaborates with clients to build talent strategies that improve employee engagement, retention, and drives organizational change. Additionally, Susan was selected as one of the top women in HR technology by Recruiting Daily and received the 2019 Leadership Award by Training Industry Magazine. And Jen is responsible for the overall execution of the Future of Work team, The Edge, to provide just-in-time ideation and innovation for worldwide companies. The goal of The Edge is to support global enterprise solutions in elevating the HCM transformation consulting experience. She has been a champion for all things analytics and innovation, women in STEM, and played a pivotal role in the development and adoption of ADP Data Cloud, among many other ADP innovations. She's been named one of the top rising women in HR technology and women in data to watch. With that, Trish, I know you and the team have a lot to talk about today, so I'll turn the event over to you.
Thank you so much. Well, welcome everyone. We are extremely excited. I know there are many times we can attend webinars where all you're seeing is some slides in front of you. We wanted to provide you something really different today, so you get to see all of our faces and sort of the behind the scenes as we talk live about the topics we have on hand. I want to first and foremost encourage you to engage and interact with us. We do have the ability for you to ask questions, so please do so using the dashboard. And then also, I want you, if you are on Twitter, to follow the Twitter hashtag working for. That's WORKINGFOR. And we will, you'll probably see a couple of times where we look to the side. We're going to watch the hashtag live as it pops up, as well as the questions that are coming in. So please do participate, and you will help guide what we talk about. And before we get started, also, I wanted to just say that, you know, as someone who has been in human resources and now work on trend reports, I've sort of been on both sides of the fence, right? I've been the person that's hopefully out there working with vendors in our industry to identify what the trends are in the world of work and what some of the best practices are. But I know it can also be a little bit challenging when you're in your organization and you sometimes feel a little overwhelmed by all the trends. And what Susan and Jen and I really hope that you walk away with today is that whatever stage you're in your organization, you are not far behind. And we will talk through how to sort of deconstruct some of those trends or best practices and make it hopefully more practical so that at whatever phase you're in, you're feeling comfortable about what some of your next steps might be. And again, please ask questions as we go along so that we can help you with that as well. So with that, we'll get started. I know we have a lot to talk about here today with Susan and Jen. You know, one of the things as we prepared with what might be a good way to just open up the conversation was around leadership. We know that as leaders, you are all tasked with not just some of the more tactical things that have to get done or compliance-driven parts of your job, but you're also really tasked with staying ahead of what's coming next. And that can be really challenging. You know, we all need probably a lot more time and a little bit less to do. So what I'd love to do is maybe, Jen, start with you. Leadership is changing pretty rapidly. What are some of the changes that you're seeing with leaders and how they have to approach their work in today's market?
Well, work has changed so much. The first question I would say is, who is leading the workforce? And when you look at who is leading the workforce, not to spend a lot of time on generations, but 50% of working millennials are who's leading our organizations today. And yet a study by this McKinsey study said that only about 33% of those millennials felt actually ready to lead. So a leader is defined by two plus direct reports, and only 33% felt ready to lead. So when you think about who is morphing into this leadership role and the path that they've taken and what they've been influenced by in terms of their own consumer lives and now how they're measured as a leader and how they lead as a leader, and then what have we supplied them with in terms of coaching and culture and inclusion, there's a lot to discuss.
I couldn't agree more. And I think that can be overwhelming, right? I mean, Susan, what about you? I know you work a lot with organizations who are kind of going through this every day. What are some of the things you're hearing in terms of, is this stressful, or are you hearing that people have this kind of figured out? What are you hearing?
Gosh, I don't know if we have it all figured out, if I'm hearing that quite yet, but I love that we're breaking it down today and just having a conversation and just bouncing ideas off of each other. When I think of leadership today, I hear that there's still this skills shortage. So who are those future leaders going to be? And right now, if you just look at the population of the age groups and you look and you say, okay, the aging population, the over 55-year-olds are going to double in size. So I hear, you know, friends, coworkers, other folks that are saying, okay, so if I take a retirement, do I have the ability to come back and work part-time? What's this shift going to look like, and how open are companies to take me back in? And do I have the ability to, one, be retrained, to get back up, you know, to speed on certain things? And can I participate part-time? And then how are companies actually going out and sourcing those folks and making it attractive for them to come back and to fit into this sort of multi-dimensional workforce, I call it today? So Jen talked about the stats with, you know, what's happening with the millennials who are going to be these leaders, and are they ready to lead? Well, when I talk to some of the universities and to others, the students that are just coming out of school and so forth, they'll admit it. They don't have the communication skills. They don't have some of that at-bats that they're needing, but they do want to grow and develop. So I think this sort of blend, if you will, that's happening with companies getting challenged with, you know, earlier retirement ages, and then this new workforce that's entering, and how do you merge this all together and build that pipeline with the skill shortage? So that's sort of what I'm seeing from that leadership area.
Right. Well, why don't we open this up to everyone? I mean, we've kind of done a little bit of where we think. Let's open it up to all of you. So why don't you tell us, I know this is not an exhaustive list, but at least to give us some direction on our conversation today, which of the following options is the most important leadership concern in your organization? Again, there could be many, but what are you most either focused on or concerned about? Is it leader effectiveness and what tools leaders and managers can have to be better? We've heard from some of the statistics that that's a certain concern. What about continuity? You know, being able to sort of nurture this next group of leaders, back to Susan's point about, you know, the millennials and how we're interacting with them. Or is it more around how you coach your teams, your existing teams? And lastly, is it more around generation? Because, you know, Susan, one of the things when you were talking about the various generations, I think too, when I think back to being an HR leader myself, it was the idea of thinking about generations in the workforce was in its infancy. We were just starting to have a number of generations in the workforce. And now I feel like it's now evolved to where it is more than just we have, you know, four or five now generations together. It's really, what are we doing to sort of make that most effective?
So that's great, Trish, because when I look at, and I don't want to talk too much about generations with, you know, the Gen Zers, but they're a smaller population. And so the millennials were a larger group. So now we look at where Gen Z is, and you thought the skills shortage, the war for talent was happening now. It's really going to happen. So I think that how wide the haystack is and how you really look at your talent pipeline and how wide you're willing to go. And I think that's a big question for folks because, I mean, I was in a conversation the other day where they were saying, well, let's look at, you know, disabled, special needs, let's look at, you know, veterans, what is it going to be for us, for our pipeline? You know, and I know specifically we're talking about leadership right now, but I'm having companies that are having discussions around rethinking what is leadership potential? What does it take to be a leader? And should we only be focusing on sort of the high potentials or those senior most levels? Should we actually be breaking it down and saying, let's go all the way to the front line, to the independent contributors, and let's figure out what those development programs are going to be for them? Because that's where the investment will be later, is to have that future pipeline. And the last point I'll make, too, is on the leadership one, is why don't we focus on the employees we have today? Let's engage those managers we have today before they leave us, because they'll be at risk, and we don't want to lose them, and it costs more to then lose them and then find and replace them. That would be my thought. What do you think there?
I agree. I'm going to go ahead and we're going to look at the answers here and see kind of where things shake out. So, okay, so leader effectiveness sort of edges out the other three, but I mean, it's interesting. So generations is probably, you know, a little bit less, but the other three are actually quite close in importance, which is interesting to me. I think what that sort of validates as I'm thinking it through is just that as leaders or thinking of the leaders that we support from an HR perspective, we have to make sure they're feeling like they are supported and empowered when it comes to all of those areas, right? So again, that probably puts a different type of stress on, you know, anyone in human resources to make sure that we're giving them a balanced approach to managing in a very new way. One of the things I've found coming up more and more, and this is whether I'm at a conference or, you know, at a local event or whatnot, wherever I'm talking with business professionals who are leaders, they definitely feel like there's more at stake than ever before. So while we might have had, like, you know, a leadership training class you would go to, again, I'm thinking way back, you know, 20 plus years ago when I was going through this myself, I could go through a course maybe on, you know, team dynamics, for example, and not really have to be measured on, well, am I doing something different with that? What did I really learn? It was more just, you know, did I go or not? I think even these answers might show that there's a lot more to it, right? We're now being expected to sort of absorb this. Jen, are you seeing that? Are you seeing that there's more expectations that come out of leaders than before or not really?
Yes, and I think the employer is also dealing with pressures from leaders expecting more and expecting more. Mm-hmm. If you look at the consumerization that the market has gone through, leaders expect many modern tools or insights in the same way that they're living their lives. If they're ordering their groceries online with their refrigerator, they certainly want to be able to use tools and use technology in a way that drives their compensation, drives their own engagement, and helps them communicate with their team as well as that online learning. And if you think about that millennial perspective or that profile that so many are leading and yet they don't feel necessarily ready for that, there's a gap that employers need to learn to lean into to help that appetite for what the leader has, because the leader wants more. And when you look at engagement studies and leaders that are leaving for less pay, it's often because they've got the tools in their hands, the insights in their hands to drive their, more of that career. And we're seeing so much sideways movement with not only the workforce, but with leadership in terms of not everybody's doing that type of hierarchical type move. They're doing sideways movements. And so yeah. A lot of that has to do with the tools and the technologies, the environment and the culture that is communicated in very similar ways as a consumer.
Yeah. You know what? I'm glad that you bring that up, because that actually kind of takes me to the next thing I wanted to talk about, and really thinking about the way that we, you know, again, probably when we all joined the workforce around the same time, it was about sort of moving up the ladder, if you will. Now the ladder mm-hmm. is, you know, all different directions, right? You
can What ladder?
That's, you can, yeah, sideways, diagonal, upside down, which I think is good. I think that's a good thing. The next part I really wanted to get into then is more around sort of performance management, because again, if you think back 10 or 20 years, we were measuring performance in a much different way. And I don't mean just from the technology standpoint of doing it once a year versus now, you know, continuous performance or things like that. But I wonder, you know, Susan, so much of what we do is to focus on performance management and the practices that sort of bolster that. Can you talk about what HR leaders should be focusing on in terms of kind of debunking some of the myths maybe around traditional performance management and where you're seeing that go with some of the customers you're working with?
Sure, that's a conundrum in itself. I mean, it's a big topic, and I'm actually seeing the shift change a little bit. Performance review is still on the forefront, but it's actually connecting to other pieces: compensation, career development, succession planning. So it's all starting to get tied together. And I think if you ask, you know, as I talk to HR leaders and ask them, you know, where are you? What are you struggling with? Many times I kind of see two different things. One, they're just trying to get started, where they're saying, I want to build the culture to have these more frequent conversations. So I do see that happening still. Like, let's have the manager and the team member connect more. And the research shows that the more frequently you connect, the higher engaged you'll be. And then the more productive you'll hope the employee will be, right? So right. I'm seeing this shift happen where there's some that don't have the tools and they're manual and they're saying, yes, I'm just trying to get a cadence going. I just want to start to move to more frequent conversations. And then I'm seeing some that are more mature that are saying, yeah, I've got all these tools now, and I just want to simplify that process. So how can I make that employee experience where I don't look, oh, my gosh, I'm going to do a performance review. How do I go find all this stuff? And now it's all there. And that's where I think technology is coming into play today. We're trying to make it easier and make it all easier. Back to your original question about the leaders. So how can the managers have the tools they need and make it a very simple process? And then to what Jim was talking about, where you can push stuff out to you, like today we're expecting all this stuff to just come to us and be ready. And that's what we're looking for. But one of the things that, you know, I still see is that my advice would be is just don't try to do what everybody else is doing, or because somebody is doing that. You have to decide what's going to work for your culture. And you have to decide, am I going to pull the Band-Aid off and go all in on this, and we're going to, this is our focus and we're all in? Or are we going to actually have a phased approach? Because many times I'll work with clients and say, so year one, you can't bite everything off this year. Year two, bite off a little bit more, and three, we'll have a little bit more. And by four, we'll actually hit all of our targets when it comes to these performance reviews. Because at the end of the day, is it really about developing these performance reviews? Why are we doing them, right? It's about enabling our employees to be better performers, about the future, where they're going. So that's where kind of where I'm seeing the shift happen. And I'll offer you just one last example of where, to tie back on the last one with leadership, is what's happening with the career conversations. So if you said, I do want to go into management, should those career conversations focus on the title, or should they focus on the role and those strengths of what you want to do? And I think that's where the pendulum is shifting now, less about a title, because as companies aren't sure where they're going, they might be doing acquisitions or changes, or structures are changing today. How do they know what those roles are going to be? And so the conversation should shift about what do you like and your strengths rather than a title, if you will.
Yeah, I agree. And I think we're going to open it up here and see what everyone else is thinking too. So you know, as you think about your, you know, you're listening to Susan and some of the things she's sharing around what she's seeing changing in the work world. What about all of you? Which currently best describes your performance management process? Would you say that you're still maybe more that traditional performance process with, you know, ratings? Are you doing a continuous process, sort of a hybrid? Oh, good. Okay. Well, see, now that's interesting too. So it's, I love that. So no, it looks like at least so far, no one's moved to all continuous, which to me, actually, that's not surprising. Now, what is interesting to me though, if you would look at a lot of the trend reports out there and not really know much about it, you would think that, oh my gosh, the whole world has moved on to continuous performance and I'm behind because I'm not doing it, right? So I think what's good about this is it shows that you really do have to look at your own culture, do what's right for your organization, and take it from there. And it's okay if you're not doing what the latest trend report says, right? It's just being mindful about where things are going and then working that into your own culture and environment as you can. We did get a really good question from the audience. I wanna bring this up and see what you both think about this. Someone said, do you think there is more of a trend toward promoting people with good leadership potential to management positions? Or are we still promoting people who've been in their jobs for a long time and just ready for a promotion? So also I'd kind of even add in the flavor of, you know, there are lots of times you get promoted because you're not necessarily a good people leader, but you're good at the subject matter. So Jen, how about you? I mean, what do you think about that? Where do you see promotions lately?
For more of the organizations that I work with, more and more, time in territory, time in position is not the indicator of the next leadership step. Somebody very successful in their domain at maybe in healthcare or in retail and selling, just because they're good at selling doesn't make them ready to lead a retail store unit. And more we're seeing leadership acknowledge that. It's been disruptive because certainly tenure actually plays a piece in that, but certainly in looking at where we need to morph that succession planning, how you fill the jobs in the right amount of time and get the right people in there has been so competitive that it's needed to change. And I think the older model is something that a lot of employers are really trying to get away from and are struggling with it. What about you, Susan?
Yeah, great, because that is a great question, because right now I have some folks saying, I'm not even sure I want to be a leader. And then you've got the folks who are just dying to be leaders, right? Mm-hmm. They think they want to be managers. And so now they're saying, well, what do I have to do to get there? Fantastic, just dialogue to be happening. And the other thing is to break it down, because if you dig deeper, and you mentioned tenure, Jen, is you look at ADP did a study, just came out this year. And actually, I wish I could hold this up for you. I'll try to hold it up. It's like this wonderful template that I have been using with clients to really say, let's diagnose at what point is the right span of control a manager should have, how much should they be getting paid, and what's the tenure or the experience they should have before they get there? Because what you want to make sure is that they aren't going to leave because now they don't have pay. They're tasked, they're overworked, right? We hear a lot about managers saying they're getting overworked. So having that clearly defined process, and then behind the scenes, if HR can go and say, let's look at the age of our managers, the tenure, the wages, the turnover, and the span of control, and then at what rate are they getting promoted? Because I think people are going to look and they're going to look and say, oh, look, you know, so-and-so got promoted, so what do I have to do? And so I really think you have to have a really clear-cut process and do some of the homework behind the scenes, which is setting us up for a data conversation later.
But I was going to say, you're talking You're talking a lot about measurement now, Susan.
I didn't mean to.
Look, we've all worked in resources, and that's the thing, right? For years, we've been telling people you've got to look at them at measuring things, right? But I can tell you, just I've worked in large organizations, small, a lot of what we were measuring was, it was new, being able to have access to a lot of data. And so I'm not saying that we were the best at understanding what to measure. Just an example, you know, if we had courses available, it was more, you know, did the person do the course? Did they not do the course, right? It wasn't, did they actually take some learning away and then go apply that learning and what happened, right? I think because of technology, we are now seeing measurement and what leaders are capable of doing to lead to these sort of, whether it's discussions around promotions or whatnot, or just performance in general, they just have many additional tools. I want to move first before we get into it to the poll question so that people have plenty of time. I apologize if I didn't leave the last one up long enough. I know a couple of people wanted to still get answers in. So as we start into sort of the analytics side, I want you to be thinking about what are some of the roadblocks that you have in your organization currently to leveraging analytics. Okay. So we have disparate data, lack of automation, the application of the data that's not actionable, or just lack of maybe expertise. So we'll leave that up there while we kind of talk about this. Jen, I'm going to go to you. And the reason is because, again, when I think back to my own experiences as a leader of mm-hmm. large, small teams, you know, a lot of what I was missing was not having use cases. You know, again, mm-hmm. I had the internet. Of course, use Google, but even today, I think sometimes it's hard to find. But more and more, it seems like companies are starting to share what best practices they have from a use case perspective, and actually sharing some of that data. You talk to a lot of companies. What are some of the use cases that you're seeing for people analytics and actually leveraging them versus just measuring something for the sake of measuring it?
I have so much passion on this subject because for HR to finally get their hands on the data and not feel that they're held hostage to IT resources, I'm sure is something you can identify with back in the day when it, as an HR executive, is that other response is, we don't have the data because I'm waiting for IT to help me. That's not up there. Yeah. Those days are gone. And the democratization of data, those are the key words for HR to evangelize, because when we are putting Fitbits on our dogs, and we have mapping software to find my dogs that was on the news this morning, we right. certainly can get the people data. And so the data warehousing shouldn't be an issue. What HR needs to really focus on now are, what are the questions I need to answer? So if it goes to leadership, and let's think about retail, and we were talking about leadership earlier. Retail managers are often incented on their turnover, their sales, their forecasting. So how can HR, let's say in retail, help the business? Well, if I'm a retailer, I work with a lot of retailers, especially some in a defensive position as Amazon comes into their market, like in Tennessee, that are in a defensive mode, or that they need to help the business grow. So if I'm a retailer and I want to grow by one of two ways. I'm either going to open a store with brick and mortar, or I'm going to look at an e-commerce strategy as I go into a new market. So HR can help the business leaders answer, which path do I look at? And some of the things that they're going to look at around the way is, what does the compensation of that market look like? How competitive is that talent pool? What are the wages with that? And boy, I need the best data money can buy to guide me on that. In addition, if I look at some key business metrics, and this is going to be new for HR, but look at the key business drivers that your business is measured on, sales and sales per square foot. HR can impact sales per square foot. Not only can they help determine, will an e-commerce or a brick and mortar strategy be good, they can then help with like a brick and mortar strategy, say, sales per square foot. What learning do we need for somebody to know how to upskill a customer, upsell a customer at the checkout? What learning do we need for other customers to know what other shoe models came in? What other kicks or other models came in on the store that we can help this mom or dad with their two kids hanging on them and upsell them into the other models and get their situation, their experience good? That learning all ties together and ties together then the business metric level of that sales. And when HR starts with why and they map back, they don't put the hype. You don't need to listen about driving people analytics and a big data science strategy. You just start simply, what does the business need to do? The business needs to grow. The business needs to answer the questions. What does the data look like? Resource-wise, I can get the resources to help me, whether I look at my internal help, the gig economy, I look to bring in the help or look at technology. And then the biggest piece I would offer in terms of use case application is, how do I get my leaders, my people, to look at the data and take action? Because people analytics was starting to get lift off the ground, and then it didn't. And I think a lot of it was they built all these things, and one smart person in the Wizard of Oz behind the scenes had access to it. That was it. One smart person had access to it, and nobody else was sharing it. So when you can give things in snackable bites to leaders intentionally, just like they get their Fortnite notifications or their Facebook notifications, in that same type of experiential but meaningful way, they know what to do with it. And I have an example of a client we worked with and some of the companies I work with might say, I'm not sure I trust my people on how to use data analytics. I am gonna have to train a lot. Yeah. And you don't. You know, Apple, Android, they're not out doing training classes on how to use mobile apps, right? But what you can do is deliver these type of insights in a mobile container, like a convenience store manager. We have a client that's a big retailer, 20,000 employees in convenience stores. And if you think about convenience stores, they're looking at 3 a.m. for drive-offs. They're looking to refill the coffee machine, right? You're trying to get that manager's attention. So to get them to take action in a way that's going to be meaningful to the organization, bite-sized bits, not reports, not big analytics, bite-sized bits that are like notifications that get them to look at it and take quick action. And those outcomes are what makes HR gather those successes win by win.
You know what? I love that, because also I think sometimes if we're sitting in human resources where we are very busy as well, right? Mm-hmm. And coming up and creating some huge report for everyone to, you know, to meet everyone's needs, that's overwhelming as well. So I like this idea of really looking at the business impact and then breaking it down into something that's more manageable for everyone, whether you're the person creating the bit with the data or you're the person consuming it. Why don't we, let's move forward and see how the answers came out here in terms of what are some of the roadblocks. Okay, interesting. Lack of automation, the data collection and analysis. You know what? I think that a lot of people who work in human resource technology would maybe find that surprising, right? Because if you're sort of embedded in it every day, sometimes we think, I'll raise my hand to that. Sometimes I think like it's farther along than it is, but time to time you talk to organizations, again, of all sizes, large and small, who feel like they just haven't had the opportunity or maybe the budget or both to automate and collect data in a way that's more efficient than doing it manually. Also, pretty high percentage there on disparate data, that it's siloed across business units and systems. And Jen, I think what I liked about what you were talking about is, again, if I'm focused more on small amounts of data that's highly personalized, specific leaders, maybe that helps break that down a little bit in terms of, you know, again, trying to work by silos as opposed to having it be more more fluid. Susan, we do have a question that came in on this before we move. I know we want to make sure that we hit some of the other topics too that we promised we would, but a really good question came in about leadership and data. And it's, do you know if there are any leadership assessments that have been proven to work to help identify those with the skills, experiences, or the DNA for leadership? Have you seen anything like that or come across anyone who's having that sort of challenge?
Well, that's a great question, because I'm seeing one, how do you know what skills somebody needs? So I actually had an HR leader ask me last week, is there like a skill gap analysis I can do to know how I can get to the next level? It's like, and I think sometimes you just have to use, it's all about the words we use sometimes. And I like to sort of just say, you can say assessment, you can use all these different kind of survey design. So I just like to keep it very simple and say, okay, so how do I know, what are the tools out there that it might, and what's the outcome of that survey that I'm gonna use? For example, if you're gonna do a leadership assessment, it may not be all one just assessment, it could take a couple. So like with ADP, we're using a tool where we do a standout tool where we're doing, check-ins. We're also having pulse surveys that come in, and we're asking the team manager and the team leader to get feedback about their performance. So it's like a 360. So there's a lot of tools out there, and it's really leveraging the one that's going to work for you. And when we talked about the one client that was a manual, and that was just trying to get on a cadence of having check-ins, and maybe it was a big deal for them to move from an annual to quarterly to weekly. But that's where they wanted to move their cadence and move the culture. And additionally, then they would wrap in some of those other pulse surveys, culture surveys, leadership assessments, to get a whole comprehensive view of that leader. And then you take all that feedback, and then that helps you assess. But there's a lot out there. I could definitely be happy to talk to somebody about it.
Good. We'll make sure we have some follow-up contact information too. And just to mention, we are getting a ton of questions, probably far more than I've ever experienced on a webinar of any sort. So please continue to ask those questions. If we don't get to you here, we will make sure that the three of us gather afterward. We will answer them, and we will then put that back out to all the attendees so you can benefit from everyone's questions. It's a good problem to have, or maybe we'll have to do a follow-up. We'll have to see how that goes. But at any rate, one of the things before we move on, I know we want to move on to the next question, and we've kind of touched on it a little bit. The idea of assessments and whatever we call them, and having sort of those gap analysis for whether it's a leader or someone who aspires just to move to another role. I'll give you just a little personal tidbit on that. I worked in Big Four public accounting, and back in the day, it was all manual, but we did have gap analysis. And I literally, from the minute I got out of college, all the way until I was probably 15 years into my career, was always worried about and looking at my gap analysis every year. Did I meet that gap? Did I, have I done the next thing? And in a way, I finally had one of the smartest leaders, CHROs at BJC Healthcare, who pulled me aside, and he said, at what point are you going to start leading and stop worrying about filling the gaps? So my caution to anyone out there is also, it's important to know what your leader's gaps are, but make sure that you're telling people, just get in there and do it. It's fine. Don't get too caught up on
gaps. I love that advice, because I also think it's also not just about assessments, but it's about the relationships you're making. So it could be a mentor, it could be a coach. So just that personal touch again, getting feedback from a colleague, a peer along the way is so helpful.
And the last thing I'll say on that one is I work a lot with a gentleman by the name of Ben Eubanks. The audience may know of Ben. He's a fellow analyst. And let me tell you, Ben, I met him when he was 24 years old. That's 10 years ago. And he has been one of the best mentors to me. So don't think it has to be someone with a leadership title. Don't think it has to be someone who is older than you or more experienced than you. Look for leadership advice from every angle, because sometimes it's those people who are in a different generation or coming up just out of college who are far more open to giving you some great ideas on how to fill those gaps and become a better leader yourself. So definitely just want to open that up. I know, watching our time here, we want to make sure we get everything we promised. Want to move to the gig economy and just touch on it briefly, because we did mention it in the last questions. One of the statistics I heard just a couple years ago was that by 2020, half of the workforce was going to be in a gig type of role, right? Someone who's either a project, they're not working directly for you as an employee. Jen, I know you and I have had some conversations in the past about the gig economy. Can you talk to all of us a little bit about, what are you seeing? Is that really, obviously we're not going to get there by 2020, but is that really a thing? What do you think gig economy really means to all of us who are in leadership roles?
So when I hear gig, I think contractors and freelancers and all the different ways that work is done today. And I think first and foremost, we have to acknowledge that work is done in a different way. And so we're not looking at employees versus contractors anymore. We're really looking at the entire worker profile. And I'm not sure that I have a lot of HR executives that I work with that have a lens into that population of contract workers. They've let it stay in procurement or finance or other areas of the business. So I think to even validate any survey in the future, HR first has to get a lens into that. And they need to bring those workers into their talent ecosystem, because they're a key piece of this modern workforce right now in leveraging the skill shortage. I met with a hospital and they said, we don't work in teams. So you don't work in teams? No, we don't use gig workers. But you focus on the patient, right? And you have several people that all come in and are measured by the patient acuity score, right? Correct. And you use contract physicians or outsourced. It was taking that language and putting it in terms that made sense to him that finally helped him connect the dots. Oh, so take the gig work aside and understand that there's a modern way to do work. And that worker profile is really where we need to start identifying. Again, that starts with putting that in the talent ecosystems for HR to view.
All right, so I'm making notes. I don't know if anyone else, when I do these, I learn as well. I love that idea of a modern worker profile. I haven't heard it phrased quite like that. And I am guilty of being the leader who was like, I'm not going to talk to you about contractors or whatnot. I'm going to only deal with employees. But what I love, the biggest takeaway for me is that, you know, in this economy, it is about the worker versus employee. Because I think if we only as HR leaders focus on the employee, we're missing half of what we're doing. Why don't we, let's do a poll question. Let's see where all of you who are listening in, what do you think about your talent acquisition strategy and gig workers? Are they playing a role right now? Is it not at all? Are you sort of like, I used to be thinking like, no way. Or is it something you're maybe just considering, you know, you're starting to think about it and wanting to get a little more information? Because again, you know, after today, we'll be able to sort of give you information if you need it about that. So we'll leave that one up there. Susan, how about you? I mean, again, I know you're talking with organizations of, you know, many different sizes and across industries. What are you hearing from some of the people you're working with about how they're using or embracing or not embracing this idea?
I think it's a little bit of a newer topic where who owns it? And I think that when I'm talking to folks, they're saying, procurement has that, or each business unit manages their freelancers or their contractors. And I think even the definition of what you call it, a freelancer or a project worker, and it brings up sort of what are definitions. And then the second one is back to sort of this hourly worker too, where it's happening with the shift between full-time and part-time. And how do you, you know, I love how you said talent acquisition. So from the recruiting perspective, who's going out and are we tracking this? What's the definition? And then how is it sort of mixing up, if you will, our workforce strategy? Because it has to align. And then what I find our HR leaders are saying, wait, our benefits don't match up to our demographics now. Mm-hmm. So we have more hourly employees. And wow, the benefits we were offering were for full-time. Well, now that doesn't work. And so now it's like all this stuff is happening to the total reward strategy and asking to say, we got to step back and reevaluate this, and it's causing some good discussion.
Yeah, I think it brings me back to what Jen was saying around just analytics in general, right? It's taking things back all the way to the idea of start with what is the business impact you're trying to create. The end result is that we want to get some type of work done, right? Whatever that work is. Mm-hmm. And so when we're rigid, and sometimes we can be that way in human resources, because again, sometimes what we're there is for to sort of put the brakes on things. But I think this is one area, especially in the way that we're thinking about how work gets done. My advice is being flexible with the way that you think about work and workers, as opposed to some of that language around title and employees. I think that's kind of the theme of this. I love how these happen because we didn't plan any of that, right? It just sort of is organic. But that's really the message, not to be too rigid and to really let things sort of develop organically in your organization. We're just going to pull up the answers.
Okay, sounds great.
Go ahead.
Oh, well, I was just going to share a personal story because I have a friend who is, you know, he's a parent, and during the day he's working full time, and then at night he is, you know, doing a part time job. And so he's like, well, wait, I'm going to shift. I'm going to do two part time jobs. He's actually having these conversations, and I'm thinking, how does HR even manage that? Because it could be two differently part time jobs, and then what is going to keep him engaged? So, and I know ADP is studying that and has research on that engagement based on how many, you know, if you have one or two part time jobs. And I think that's just a whole different dynamic today of, you know, having those conversations that we have to be prepared for.
But I feel as HR leaders, that's what we've been asking for that, you know, for the 25 years I've been doing it, that's what we were begging for, right? We wanted more strategic conversations. We wanted to be very strategic about how we lead and help our business. And this is it. To me, that's the opportunity. It's, you know, it is trying to, you still have to do the compliance things, of course, but it is having conversations and being open to these new ways of working. So, all right. So we're going to check the results here on gig workers. So, okay, look, we have, I mean, it's close to half. Well, honestly, if you look at the no, not at alls and those that are just thinking about it, which kind of implies they're considering it, but not doing it yet. So still a majority, a solid majority of people not really having that be a major part of their talent strategy. So again, I think if you were, this is just another great example. We didn't know how that question would turn out, but it's another example of if you were to look at the trend reports out in the world around resources, you would think that you would be the only company in the whole world who has not embraced gig work. But
you're not.
Or, you know, 1,000 plus attendees, definitely not the case today. So I think that's good though. That to me, it would make me feel better. If I'm in a human resources role, to think, you know what, it's okay then. If I'm not doing it yet, that's fine. Or maybe I just need to rethink the way I'm titling things or considering things. Or if you're someone who's rigid about it, maybe today is the day you sort of look at yourself in the mirror and say, okay, maybe I need to loosen that up a little bit and be a little more flexible about workers versus employees, right? So, great.
Yeah, okay. Trisha, I was just going to say, sometimes I get questions on this one. It's not necessarily about the gig economy, but it's the shift defining workers and how that sort of the type of worker and where they're coming from and how much time they're willing and what they want to do. And I think that's the question, because if you're trending toward part-time, is it because you're not finding full-time, and what's the brand? So I get a lot of companies are actually working on their brand strategy to say, you know, is it clear that our company is looking at this and we're open to it, and our recruiters are talking about these success stories we're having, you know, in our hiring. So it's all that sort of getting all the front end messaging up too and saying, hey, we're doing this, and or we want, or we're open to it. And I think that's sometimes the struggle, not even knowing what's possible.
Well, that's a great point. And I think too, if I were sitting solidly in human resources still in an organization, I think one of the things I'd be doing if I wasn't, and I can guarantee I never did this when I was doing it, I'd be having those conversations. I'd be pulling the recruiting team and the procurement team together right now and having a roundtable discussion about it, just to see, like, let's just level set. What do we all think?
Just check it out.
Talking about silos, boy, those are some pretty hardcore silos sometimes. So yeah, be that bridge, be that person that's kind of reaching out, and the impact you can make just on that conversation might be immense. So good. Well, one of the things that's come up in a couple of the questions, I want to move on to actually to our next topic and polling question here, is around personalization. And we've talked a little bit about it, but what I would love to know from our audience as we kind of tackle it is, what is the personalized approach for employees, and is that important to you and your business? So pretty easy, yes or no, or if you're just unsure about the value, but do you feel that a personalized approach is important in the way that you do work? And, you know, Susan, I want to ask you about this, because we've talked a little bit about it with some of the use cases you've dealt with here lately. Are you seeing that when you're out meeting with leaders, both human resource leaders and other parts of the business, how important is personalization to someone's career path or their experience? Are you hearing that come up much, or is that still just kind of a trend that we're going to watch?
I definitely think it's a trend. I think it's a challenge of, I don't know if we have all the answers yet. Because it's not easy, but I do think you have to have a plan and prioritize where all the right places are that you want to personalize at this time, because you can't do it all. But I know, like me, I wouldn't say I'm lazy, it's not the right word, but you love to have stuff come to me. I want it to be easy. So when I just look at learning and development and career discussions, wow, isn't it just great when things come to me? And I literally, one came to me last week. It was a development item that got pushed out of one of my pulse surveys I did, and the feedback came back and it said, here's what you should do, or items to consider to say no. Here's how to say no. And boy, do I need, that was like perfect timing. I was like, oh, great, I need this right now. And all it did is come to me on my email, and I just looked at it and on my mobile device, and I read it, and I said, I need to practice that more. And I hear, and I honestly, the timing could not have been better. How to say no, such a simple thing. But when I look at personalization, the timing was perfect. I got excited by it. I could tell I got pumped up. And I thought, I'm really going to practice this. And I just think of myself and how I went, it's easy. I didn't have to go look somewhere. I didn't have to go dig somewhere into another system and log in. And it wow, just, the stars aligned. And so that to me is, I think, that aha moment that employees are looking for that. And so when you're trying to create that atmosphere, how do you make it easy for them? And I think that's exactly where we're trying to go, because you don't want anybody to waste their time. You don't want right. to have to go, I'm going to take this course, or I just want to clip out, right? I just kind of want to scoot to the next section. And now yeah. we're even testing things and learning where we're watching the behaviors of where you clicked, you know, and watching to say, hey, maybe we'll guide them. We'll ping them real quick so they don't get hung up here. Well, it looks like they're having trouble. We'll help them here. So I think that's where I just picked learning as a good example where I got excited about that personalization, if you will.
I love that. And I love that it kind of goes back to, again, that overarching theme of keeping things simple, right? Let's see what the answers are here. Oh, hey, okay. Now that's, I'm obviously a little surprised. I know, in a good way. I'm glad. 78%, almost 79% say it is important to have. So, which leads me to probably, we don't have like the big elephant in the room of AI, right? Artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. Every trend report mentions it. Everyone that I talk to is like, what can I do to learn more about it? And to, you know, and artificial intelligence and things like machine learning, those are some of the very parts of the technology that push some of those more simple things out to you as an employee to give you that personalized experience. Jen, I want you to weigh in. I know you do a lot with innovation, and your team obviously highly focused on innovating around that. What are you seeing in terms of the industry embracing machine learning, artificial intelligence, and having it apply to, you know, all of these topics that we're talking about today? What should people know?
First, it's not that hard to lean into AI. I think don't be intimidated by it, but actually don't start there. So when we have somebody say to us, well, where's your AI? I would ask why. What are you looking for? What are you looking to augment in your experience? And kind of on the heels of that personalized approach, a great example, and I always use the consumerized world as an example because that's what our workers are experiencing, is look at facial recognition. That's certainly one method of AI deployed with facial recognition. Is it any wonder that workers then want the same type of experience in unlocking the software or the technology that they're supposed to communicate with their employers? But of course. And in our innovation labs, we actually have two labs. We have user experience research labs, and we watch all of these cues of where do the eyes go to? Where do they experience the friction points? Where do they have grimaces in the technology as they fill out different forms or different experiences? And being mindful that the consumer world, all the Angry Birds that our parents played for years and years, are actually mm-hmm. having so many different learning impacts on what they expect now in technology. And so with AI and machine learning, the first thing to know is, well, you want to jump right into that, you've got to have good data and a lot of data. So on the news this morning, I saw that there's going to be find your pet, that you can take a picture of your pet and match it and it will find it. Oh, that's fantastic. You've got to have a lot of pictures of your pet to be able to match it with all the different algorithms. So that's going to take time to build. So it starts great. Others say, well, I want to look at chatbots. Where do you want to look at chatbots? Think of the consumer experience. When I am on the airlines, not to be mentioned, I'm so thankful for that chatbot or that virtual assistant that lets me change my canceled flight versus calling and standing in line like a lemming, right? Mm-hmm. So it's a great experience. And those are some of the things that translate over to the worker experience then, and some of the things that we need to prioritize. And so like I sound a little bit preachy at times. I'm like, just start with the use case. Start with the biggest use case that you have prioritized right now. If it is you're getting a flood of phone calls on learning, or you're getting a flood of phone calls on pay, where in your environment, where in your experience can you give your worker, and I say workers intentionally for both the contract, gig, freelance, and your employees, where can you give them one experience to get the right information in line? And chatbots, virtual assistants, a lot of data needs to be gathered. So you're going to start small. And you might have to start as a real live chatbot, and maybe you deploy that internally, or maybe you lean on other technologies to augment that. But the idea is to get those quick wins, eliminate bias, and having other stakeholders in this meeting look for risks and a lot of data. I can't stress, a lot of good data at the bones, at the root of that, no matter what, has to be the guardian golden rule, if you will.
Right. Let's take a pause while we'll keep the conversation going, but I at least want to put up the last polling question too, which is about AI. So people feel free to answer as we kind of have the discussion, but do you believe that artificial intelligence and talent is valuable to your organization? And it's okay if you think it's not. Please answer, whether or not you're just not interested in this at this time, or if it's just something you're curious but not really sure how to use it, or if you think, you know what, we are ready, but we're not, you know, starting to explore it, but not there yet, or do you have this? Are you already starting to really use AI in your HR and talent practices? So we'll leave that up there for a moment. As we're kind of coming to the end here, I want to be sensitive. Let's probably got another 2 minutes or so that we can talk before we want to just kind of wrap it completely. But, Susan, we've talked a lot about use cases, and Jen just mentioned that's a starting point, right? You want to start there. What types of questions are you hearing from the HR leaders that you're working with when it comes to artificial intelligence? Are you hearing, would you say, are you feeling people are curious? Are they ready? What state would you say you're hearing people are in?
Yeah, I definitely think people are curious. I mean, they're hearing all about it, but I come in and do strategic workshops with our clients, and we just basically look, you have to look at the whole strategy and say, let's look at the whole HR strategy and find out where the right place is, because you may be putting something in that's tactical and putting it in to take out a task, but it could have a greater impact somewhere else on the front end. Or it could be that they're not looking at the root cause of the problem. And so one thing may trigger another one. And the other piece of advice I have is that technology is not meant to, it's meant to support, not replace. And so AI is there really as an assistant to the human. So I think many times is going back and saying, okay, well, if I'm going to have that chat bot and we're having that conversation, it's replacing that human touch. So you really have to step back and ask yourself, is this chatbot replacing the human? Is it the right thing? And what does it have an impact on our brand and us as a company for the short term or the long term? And I think that's a big analysis. But our team will go through and walk through certain questions to say, how do I know where's right? And I think one of the very, very first things we talked about at the beginning of our coffee or our conversation today was having that that data and knowing where the right place is and where to ask those really good questions. Is it tied to a strategy and the business issue? That would be my advice.
I love that. That's such a good, it's a good to tie to that strategy. And sometimes I'll be honest, it's, you get into the tactical parts of your day, you're maybe not thinking about that overarching strategy. So always good advice to go there. Let's see how the answers came out. Okay, so it looks like we have a majority who are curious. We have a good number, almost 40% that are just not interested in that just yet. And I would expect that, I think that it is something, again, a lot of these topics that we hear in human resources, sometimes you just get a lot of talk and chatter about them, but you're really not quite sure what to do. I think that's why it's helpful to have conversations like we are today with you, Susan, and you, Jen, because you were actually able to hear about use cases, actual companies doing it in all different industries. Whereas, like, again, when I'm, if I'm in human resources, it's just me. I may have a friend or two I can reach out to, but it's always good to have someone in talking with large numbers of companies around these things. So anything surprising to you as we, again, we've got probably another minute here before we need to start wrapping, but Jen, anything surprising by the results here, or would that be what you really expected?
I love the curious. I welcome the curious. Those that are like, I don't know, like maybe even I don't know in HR how much I should get into AI versus wait for IT to do it. I would tell you 50%, according to McKinsey, 50% of your workers' activities are already augmented in the business some way, shape, or form by AI. Whether it's robotic process automation, facial recognition, chatbots, assistance, some way the business is already augmented. So I would say stay tuned. It's coming to a theater near you if it hasn't hit you yet. And it's the sooner you lean in with that curiosity, the better you're going to find that placement competitively against those that you recruit and compete against in your business sector. And I think that's the end of the day, is we really need to look at these type of levers for HR to leverage, because HR is our secret weapon in being competitive.
Ooh, I like that. HR is the secret weapon. Gosh, that's a good way to end it.
Go HR.
Go HR. Before I'm going to turn it over to Tina here in a minute. Ladies, thank you, first of all, for inviting me to have this conversation. Thank you to all of the people who listened in. We will follow up on all the questions, like I said. I think what's interesting to me, like I said, is to sort of see, this was very a little bit of planning, a lot of let's just see what we want to talk about. Mm-hmm. Some important things came out of this. We talked about just asking why. We talked about keeping things simple. And measuring what has business impact. I think those are three great takeaways that people can go back with. So Tina, why don't I turn it over to you. Jen, Susan, thank you so much for having the conversation today, and I look forward to many more.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ladies, for that incredible discussion, a really collaborative, so much great information for people to walk away with. So unfortunately, based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. Your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email. And if you requested CPE credit when you registered, you should be able to access your credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. And on behalf of Trish, Susan, Jen, myself, the entire team at ABP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future events. Thank you so much and have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you.